welcome to the talk of the from the Dutch Chamber of Commerce. We are asked to give a presentation here, and we chose the subject. It's all about revocation, and it's about the journey we as Chamber of Commerce did by investigating blockchain and SSE, and doing a talk very, very short about who we are, a bit longer about what the Chamber of Commerce is, and then the learnings of our journey into investigating blockchain and self-sovereign identity for the Chamber of Commerce, and what our role could be in these new ecosystems, and also examples of the self-sovereign identity slash wallet projects we do now. So, and thank you all for attending, firstly. So about us, it's not only me. We do this talk with the three of us. My two colleagues are sitting over here. Very short about me, Joost Fleuren. I have an engineering studies. I did do real code development in the past. Nowadays, it's more my product is more PowerPoints about what we should build, why, and with who. It's also interesting. And so it's about translating more to business applications. And then we have Michiel. Maybe you want to introduce yourself very shortly.
Also studied at Delft Technical University Industrial Design Engineering. Made a move from product designer to developer, front-end development first, full-stack developer now. Mainly JavaScript, so favorite stack is React Node.js. And my daily job at Innovation Lab is mostly building proof concept MVPs of ideas that we got from Innovation Lab. We want to test among users, and then I start building proof concepts.
Yes, and I'm Willem Scalogne. Also studied at the Technical University in Delft. Never saw those guys there, by the way. Used to be a product owner, made on ondernemersplan.nl, did a pilot, main overheid voor ondernemers. And now the same as Joost, the main product is PowerPoints and IDs to help others make real things and translate things into applications.
Thank you. So I often ask Michiel to, hey, can you develop this? About the Chamber of Commerce. Welcome. So, please take your seat. So, about the Chamber of Commerce. We already exist for a while, the Chamber of Commerce. It was incorporated in 1803. As the Kamer van Koophandel en Zeevaart en Fabrieken. And as of today, we are an independent administrative body under supervision of the Ministry of Economic Affairs. In Dutch, that's a zelfstandig bestuursorgaan. So we are basically civil servants performing tasks which are in the law, which is, for example, the trade registry. And we are approximately 1,800 people strong. And well, what does our organization deliver then? For example, two websites, kvk.nl and Ondernemersplein, which generate 45 million visitors a year. So that's not small. We provide advice to entrepreneurs, 116,000 calls a year. We have three registries, which generate 47 million API calls or online lookups. So it's quite significant in volume. And we provide different things like certificate of origins, also a large amount, more than 700,000 a year. So it's not a small organization. And it's also more than an IT organization than it was in 1806. And Michiel will very quickly tell something about that.
Yeah, so a bit more about the organization. There's about 800 people working for a Chamber of Commerce, of which 500 developers, technical related, not all developers. And those about 500 developers build, update, maintain, support 260 applications. So there's one developer at the Innovation Lab, that's me. The stacks that are most used within the Chamber of Commerce is Microsoft.NET and React. So that's mostly used in the online team that's working on the websites that Joost just talked about. And in the more the Wooda-based team, which is more working on the trade register itself, maintaining the trade register, building APIs on top of that, they mostly use Java. And in that same team, there's the different applications built for internal use, and they use Angular whenever there's front-end involved. So there's just want to quickly talk about the tools and platforms that the Chamber of Commerce delivers. Chamber of Commerce has several development teams, and they work as DevOps, so they are responsible of development, but also responsible for operations. And to be able to do that, Chamber of Commerce provides a Kubernetes platform that's running on premise. So there's Excel machines, a big server room that that's running Kubernetes as a dedicated team that supports and maintains that. I was possibly surprised by this, and that helped us as Innovation Lab as well. So this means that the development, the DevOps team can, choose. They can run their code within a Docker container, so they can choose whatever operating system framework they like, and whatever language they want to use. I'm going to skip the Microsoft Azure. We use that for Innovation Lab ourselves only. So and next to it, there's a GitLab instance running within Chamber of Commerce. In combination with Kubernetes, it means that you can do as a DevOps team. You're completely flexible. If you're a big team running a lot of an application that has a lot of users and needs to of which we need to make sure that it keeps running. You can have set up a complete Git flow pipeline. You can configure that yourself. But for us, Innovation Lab, this probably a lot of that's overkill. So I can choose just a smaller pipeline that's fit for need, and we can just quickly test something without the whole shebang. And last but not least, there's from the front-end team, the online front-end team, there's a big React component library, which is very well organized. It's good supported, good documented, whenever we want to, as Innovation Lab, want to just quickly create something, we can pretty much drag and drop all the components to quickly create a front end, and that is very nice. There's lots more, of course, but this is just the most important things I want to point out.
Thank you, Michiel. So we're a real IT organization. That's kind of the takeaway from this. And okay, the talk now is about blockchain SZ and our journey into that. I'm not sure if there are a lot of real blockchain fundamentalists or enthusiasts here. Basically what we did is we dove into it when the whole blockchain became more and more of a buzz thing in the news, etc., about what does it mean for us? And what does it mean for us? Michiel just explained how state-of-the-art IT organizations we are now. Well, we came from a different era, and our trade registry is not that old as our organization. It's from the 1920s. And to give you into perspective, the 1920s cars look like this, traffic lights look like this, radios look like this. And this was the way how you would store information. You would just type it. And this is actually a picture of the KVK in the 1970s. We had this old file cabinets where people would store the information in and type it, and people would ring, and they could get an excerpt, or we would answer on the phone what the status was of a company. So apparently, there's a lot of value in having a trade registry. Otherwise, you wouldn't do all this efforts, all this efforts. And well, it makes you wonder what's the value of it? What's actually the value of a trade registry? Why are we here? That's always a good question to answer, of course. And the main reason for the trade registry is certainty of doing business. So people want to interact with other people. Companies want to interact with people or other companies. And they know they need to know who they are doing business with. That's kind of the underlying thing we provide. And derived from that, you also create trust. So I know who you are, so I can deal with you because I know who you are. And I can check on you. So what is the Chamber of Commerce Trade Registry? Trust by administrating a registry. And that's a basisregister, is how we call it in Dutch, a basic registry from the government. And we're not the only basisregister in the Netherlands. There are in total 10 of them. Very well known is the Gemeentelijke Basisadministratie. It's where all the identity characteristics of the natural persons are stored in. The characteristics which end on your identification card, for example. There's the kadaster, the registry for buildings. Who owns this building? How tall is it? Where is it actually located? And there's the Chamber of Commerce with the trade registry. And seven more. So for our registry, it's the single source of truth. I mean, what we mean with that is people should be confident that what's there is the legal truth. So you kind of can base your actions on that. So also that's why the law says what's in the trade registry is true. So and if it's not true, it's still true, but it's kind of the responsibility of the person who's registered to check it and keep it up to date. So people know what they're dealing with. So trust, that's what we derive. And then very short, well, how works that registry? What is it and what boils it down to? It's a database, right? It's a database and we manage the database and we manage it by checking who is doing entries in this database. So we have aan de registrerende kant, we have a part where we check who you are physically when you come to our office or online with DigiD. And based on that, we decide if you may mutate it or you can start a new company and become a record in our database, or you can change the characteristics of your company. And we also manage the whole history, we archive it, etc. So that's in the core what we do. And then, of course, we also make sure the database is accessible. So if somebody wants to look into it to check if you are really you from that company, they can look into our database. And in the old days, we would send you this, a typewritten with a typewriter, written paper with the company characteristics. Nowadays, that's also digitally signed PDF, a SOAP XML API, a REST API, in the future GraphQL, for example. And what our department does, where Michiel's the developer, and my colleague, we check what's next. That's basically the task for us. What's next? What's the next big thing? So we know how we should anticipate on that. And when we do that, we observe the outside world and we see that, for example, there's more and more demand for straight-through processing. So I want to check this database and automatically put the information in my system. And we also see a much more focus on privacy, the GDPR or in Dutch AVG, and that we also want to give the persons, natural persons who are in the database, more control about what's actually happening with the data. That's also a trend we see in society. Well, and this is kind of like the picture was used to introduce our department. So if it's a shielded environment where we can kind of put things in the ground and see if they can grow up or not. Kind of a bit of an experiment. And in the beginning I started about Bitcoin. Well, obviously, this was how it started, with the paper in 2008. And what happened after that is that with all the Bitcoin, it became more and more in the picture. And that's, I think, mainly because of the value people trusted to the system. So also within the Chamber of Commerce, they asked, hey, what does it mean for us? Because apparently this is very popular, it works very well. People say it's about trust and it's a new way of trust, it's a new way of storing value and trusting it. So what does it mean for us? So that's basically what I did. I did look into that, and well, what I first started doing is checking if that's the first cryptocurrency there is or not. And surprisingly, that's not the case, right? So in the Netherlands, we already had the Chipknip and the Chipper, which are basically also cryptocurrencies which worked and were safe and secure, and they came and they did go. Before that, in America, you had also the DigiCash, also which these guys developed in the 90s, also worked, kind of disappeared. But apparently, there was something different about this whole Bitcoin and blockchain, that it became so hugely popular, and so and people did trust so much value in it. And yeah, what was that? That was the big question, of course. So what did we do? We looked into the source, of course, of it. And well, that's the Bitcoin paper. And what you read in that is actually quite interesting. That is the old system, near Sanatoshi, how he describes this, worked very well. But it suffered the inherent weakness of the trust-based model. Well, that's for the guy selling trust, of course, not what he wants to hear. So, and even more, right, completely non-reversible transactions are not really possible. And that's apparently what the people need. Okay, that's interesting. So, no trust-based model. It's immutable. The blockchain is immutable. That's apparently also very important. And no organization. So it makes you wonder, are we this turkey before Christmas? That's also was, of course, a bit popular to say, hey, the whole world will change as blockchain. Do you still need a registry? Blah, blah, blah. Okay, now, let's look into it. So what we did as an innovation lab, we participated in all kind of research projects, for example, Techruption, that like there are banks in, government agencies, blockchain developer companies, etc. And we did all kind of experiments. And the Dutch government also had the Dutch Blockchain Coalition we are part of, which also did all kind of experiments with the goal of investigating this whole new technology and see how we can make it applicable for the Netherlands. So, what can we as an organization do with it? So that's what we did. And during this talk, I will try to kind of like just tell what we learned from it and what were our takeaways. So if you look at the blockchain, obviously Bitcoin is the successful application of that. If we dive into that, it's the blockchain lives in the cloud, the Bitcoin on the blockchain, and it's independent. It has not real governance, you could say. It is not a single point of failure. And so that's all nice. But what it also is that the value of the whole Bitcoin is stored in the blockchain. That's kind of what we kind of what did strike us most, because the value of basically what you sell and what you administrator is the fact that you have this coin in the blockchain which lives in the cloud. So okay, so what you sell or what you buy is also this little spot in the blockchain in the cloud. And if you look in again, in the paper itself, you also see that. So I coined this private key. I administrated the public key in the blockchain, and I can trade that to somebody else so he can administrate his private key in the blockchain. So, and I think that's an important thing to recognize. Also, I think why the Bitcoin is very works very well, and it's a system which is still there, and you don't see that many other applications because it's all enclosed in one blockchain. So I trade basically places in this blockchain, and that's it. And we value that very much. That's an observation. Then this whole research group started to do more. People want to develop more applications on the blockchain because it was good, etc. So one application, for example, was smart contracts. One of the things Michiel and I looked into is about how can you develop smart contracts on the blockchain, on the Ethereum, etc. And obviously, because you have this whole promise of independence, no governance, no single point of failure. But there's one thing really different then, if you do smart contracts on a blockchain, you need to connect to the outside world, right? Because you have a contract with somebody. And the somebody is not always in your blockchain cloud, can also be has to be also outside the blockchain. Eh? At least the information which you fire off these smart contracts comes from outside the blockchain. So you add an extra complexity in it. Well, first, this interaction with outside the blockchain. Well, that's why the oracles come into play. Eh? So I need to have some input in my blockchain cloud. So I have an oracle which I recognize for being some kind of truth about something. And I have the people or the organizations that interact with my blockchain. So I need some kind of identity access management. Eh? So to recognize this person and maybe also on behalf of which company he acts. And that's also the point where a lot of people always in these research projects look to me or look to my colleague from the Rijksdienst van Identiteitsgegevens, because we have a fundamental ingredient we need. That's knowing who knocks on my blockchain. So it's not turkey for Christmas, it's actually the guy providing some kind of basic component to this whole ecosystem. Which is in itself not very surprisingly, right? Because even when we had the typewriters, people needed this whole fundamental identity and the registry, and that's still the case. Next to that, what you also saw was people need kind of agreement on definitions. So I have a smart contract. Well, what am I talking about? Am I talking about what kind of currency or what kind of things? You need somebody basically also to police it, right? To keep bad people out or to, if there are disputes mediation. And you need to know if it's all, what you can expect from it being online or not. So to summarize, this is what we all want. We say we want and we really want, but this is also what we really need. And that's also, and you can basically summarize it as somebody managing that. So that's all positive, and that's actually not really surprisingly if you look at the original Bitcoin blockchain paper, because the whole blockchain, how it was set up for the Bitcoin, was basically, as Howie also writes it in his introduction, to avoid mediating disputes, because there are costs if you can actually mediate disputes. Because if you control something, that's what we also know, there's always something knocking on your door who wants something from you. And that can also be very legitimate things. For example, all my cash was stolen, you manage this cash registry, so you should give me my cash back. Well, it's not possible in the blockchain, so you don't have this cost, but if you manage actually a registry, you need to kind of set the wrong things right. A lot of other things. Okay. What we also saw is that all these research groups about blockchain, they kind of driven away to a second new technology development, and that was self-sovereign identity. And I think that was partly because we all recognize that identity is a very important ingredient in this new self-sovereign world, as you could say it. Also, if you look at the blockchain as like an independent self-sovereign thing that lives there. And you need this identity as an ingredient, but identity itself could also benefit from a more technological independence. So, so what's self-sovereign identity? It's about managing identity in an independent way. And how can you best explain what self-sovereign identity is? So it's independent, controlled by the user. It's privacy that you decide what to do. Maybe you can best compare it to the identity card in your wallet. So, and there's a very fundamentally different thing with your identity card in your wallet. And when you log in with your identity nowadays online with DigiD or another way how you can prove your identity online. Because if I show my wallet to you, then I'm in control. I see that I show it to you. And I can also decide what I disclose to you, because I can just partly show it partly, etc. And nobody else knows I show it to you. The thing is, if you log in with, for example, DigiD, it's logged somewhere. So people know where you log into. And is that a bad thing or not? Well, maybe it is bad if it's registered somewhere that every evening you prove to the online liquor store that you're older than 18. Or that you log into a mental health clinic. So privacy around your real identity is a real important thing. And there's a huge demand basically to provide that. And the next picture I have is about how would an online event look then? I think the best way the best visual is this. This is the driving license you can put in America in your Apple wallet nowadays. And it's not self-sovereign, but it has some privacy enhancing features. So I have it and I can decide who I show it to in that attribute. And and of course we kind of dreamed how KVK identity looked into it. So we made this mock-up. So wouldn't it be great if you're an entrepreneur and you are somewhere physically or online, you can just disclose your identity attributes. I think there's a huge value of it. I think there's huge value for the users, and there's also huge value for society if you can make that in the privacy friendly. So now I will dive into more technically what self-sovereign identity is, and I will also kind of like underscore the same parallels we saw with the blockchain world, and why also we still have a very important, significant role there. So a self-sovereign identity is basically a wallet with your identity information, and there are all kind of standards now coming up, verifiable credentials from W3C is one. And so I hold my identity credentials. That's great. Of course, I need to get them from somebody. Yeah? So if I just say it's me, that's also a value, because you can know when I'm a returning customer that it's still me. But it's of course better if you can disclose your real identity from the government. So some issuer needs to put your identity in the wallet, and from there you have control over it. So you can choose who to show it to, which verifier you show it to, and also what you disclose. And that's independent, right? So that's great. So I'm independent. I just like my old identity card in my wallet. I can show it to you, and I'm the guy who actually decides if I want to do it. And it's only me who actually knows that I showed it to you. So independent, no governance, privacy preserving, all great. No single point of failure. Except that here's also the value with, again, outside, the value is in interaction with outside this whole independent wallet, because maybe not with your identity characteristics, because your date of birth won't change anymore. But for example, if it's a company identity, it can change, and it can change overnight, and your company can change, can go bankrupt, for example. And that's very relevant to know. So you end up with verifying if these credentials are still up to date. And that's what we also always saw with Michiel, because we developed some of those self-sovereign identity wallets. It all boils down to revocation. So it's all independent, up until the question that you want to know, are you still this person, or don't you live anymore? Or is this company still alive and kicking? Or are you still the director of this company? So you always end with some kind of verification, which you can do technically with some decentralized network, so it's still privacy preserving, so that works. But at the end, you always need to feed it with the source being us. So revocation, that all boils down to us. So that's our spot in this whole ecosystem there. So my take on SSE, I think it's very good for society. We the people really need it. It's privacy preserving, brings back control to the person who's registered, gives you independence. But you also want certainty and the ability to check and fall back on trusted institutions. And so it will be there. It will be rooted in a chain of trust. And I think we should be that chain of trust, and there's a need for it. And what I generally think of it, shoot for the moon, and if you miss, you land among the stars. And I think that's with a lot of developments. And this picture, I think, describes what I personally really think it will go to. So this whole self-sovereign identity will not be really self-sovereign, but I think the next 10 years we'll go to the age of more user-centric. So internet is full of aliases. So I make my account and I kind of live along with my self-created account. And more we will have more tools where you can actually prove who you are or prove certain attributes who you are. And that will be more the basis of interacting with online services. And when they are privacy preserving, you can also, I think you're less reluctant also to do that. And it's not only us, it's also the European Union who thinks like this. So there's a huge project about creating a European Union identity wallet with all the safeguards in it. And yeah, so what we now do is experimenting with this new wallet technology. And that's what Willem is going to talk about. So he's going to talk about the joy we have in looking how can we then feed such an wallet. Willem.
And to learn about all the things we don't know about wallets. EU is betting on a wallet. I think yesterday Google announced Google Pay. They're going to transform it into a Google wallet, like the Apple wallet, with all kinds of attributes and credentials in it. So at least we're not the only ones thinking in this direction. That's a good thing, I guess. Joost has spoken about a trade register 3.0, 4.0, whatever you want to call it. But it was quite theoretical, like on a blockchain, on self-sovereign identity. We like to experiment with this technology and with the interaction that's needed to prove this technology. How can we provide trust? Who needs trust in what use case? When does he need to trust? And how can you physically handle that trust? Like the typewriter, you got a paper, and with that paper you go to the bank and you said, see, I'm the chief officer of this company and I want a loan. So what kind of use cases do we see that needs trust derived from the trade register? I want to work at your construction site. I want to create an event in order to sell tickets, like the Pink Pop tickets servicing. I'd like to apply for a building permit. I'd like to ask for a loan. I'd like to make a quotation, or I'd like to rent a car. And what you see is that the verifier always asks the same kind of questions in those situations. They're always specific, but there's a red line between them. Who are you? On behalf of which company? The identities Joost was talking about. The personal identity in combination with the company. And sometimes, like I'd like to rent a car, you have to provide more credentials, like if you have a driver's license or that you're older. So let's see how that's gonna how that could work. I guess most of you guys are somehow familiar with the concept of a wallet, in which we're already accustomed to having a debit cards or credit cards in them. If you're on Android, you'll see that wallet arriving soon, I guess. You can have your flight tickets in it. You can prove that you're sane enough to drink a beer in a bar. And sometimes, and when it comes to more complex situations where you need a trade register, you need information from more than one card. Like if you want to rent a car as an entrepreneur, you need a driver's license. You need to prove that you're over 24. And you need to prove that you actually run a business, so you can ask for an invoice instead of paying directly. And then what are the questions we have when we explore this new technology, these new concepts, these new paradigmas? Where are the responsibilities? How's the price model going to change? What do we need as Chamber of Commerce, as we are expecting, as people are coming to us as a verifier? What's the exact functionality that is already present? Do users really adopt this new kind of interaction? Thank God for COVID. Are there showcases? Can we prove this technology and this functionality by having real showcases? Of course, very important to us. What does it need? What do we need to do if we want to issue credentials to those systems? What standards are used? How secure is it? What's the IT impact on our company? And I'd like to show you three cases just out of it on different kinds of where we experiment and we want answers on different kinds of things that we saw all around this. With the Dutch Agency of Vehicles, we intend to do a test, a pilot proof of concept, primarily to ask the technology questions. What are the standards of a verifiable credential? How is that going to work? How secure is it? What are those standards? Because they're not all all extremely finished right now. They're still under construction. And what are we going to test? Some owner of a company is trying to somehow getting his personal credentials, like his personal number, personal identification number, BSN in Holland. Comes to the Chamber of Commerce, and of course, it was all about revocation. Nice to know that you were the owner yesterday, but are you still the owner? So somehow we have to check the revocation. Is this person revocated? Is he still alive? Chamber of Commerce gives a credential providing he's the owner. He can delegate some of his authority to an employee. Employee can go to the Chamber of Commerce with that credential and receive a new credential that he's allowed to suspend a car. That's the use case we have here. And the employee goes to the Dutch Vehicle Agency with his Chamber of Commerce credential, his suspend credential, and with that credentials, he suspends the car. But the RDW only suspends the car if he wants to know that those credentials are still valid. So somehow we have to check for is one of those credentials revocated or not. This helps people in a frictionless way to suspend cars. Of course, this is already possible, but on with a login token with a Dutch agency of vehicles. But this way, it's privacy friendly, frictionless, and it should be in a cheaper ecosystem than right now. And of course, the person who handles a company's car lot can suspend all vehicles. If a vehicle is not driven, you don't want to pay taxes, you don't want to pay insurance. So a frictionless way we offer as an ecosystem to people who want to suspend cars. And of course, this is not a high volume use case. This is basically to learn about the technology, the revocation, and the trust between governments and how we're going to provide that. Another one is physical access. In a completely different setting, not online suspending a car, but people need access to a harbor and in the harbor to a ship. And due to anti-terrorism laws, there are very many restrictions to entering a harbor. You have to prove who you are, what you're going to do there, if you're on the harbor, on which ship you go. So there are very many checks who you are. And a SSI ecosystem could provide that. This is what we built with Show ID, based on the trust derived from the trade register. It's not entirely self-sovereign, but I think when you go experimenting with concepts, in the end you try to find something that actually helps the use case, and that's what Joost already said. Real SSI, I don't think it's the next thing like tomorrow. So if you want to have real use cases and you want to provide them, user-centric is the first step, and probably later, real SSI things come. I spend all night translating this,
Dit is Jurgen van de Hulle, eigenaar van Elektrabrand BV. Elektrabrand verricht reparaties en onderhoud aan schepen, en Jurgen komt daarvoor regelmatig op schepen die in de haven liggen. Havens zijn goed beveiligd. En om in de haven en op het schip te komen, moet Jurgen zich identificeren en bewijzen dat hij namens het bedrijf Elektrabrand mag optreden.
Wanneer wil jij Show ID inzetten?
Ik zou Show ID heel graag willen inzetten. We kunnen heel snel achter de identiteit van de persoon komen, of die geautoriseerd is om op het terrein te komen. En we kunnen heel snel implementeren in ons dienstrapportage, dus het werkt veel sneller.
Show ID is het digitale toegangsbewijs waarin de identiteit van de bezoeker wordt vastgesteld. Maar ook of iemand geautoriseerd is om een bepaalde handeling te verrichten, zoals het optreden namens een bedrijf. Hoe werkt Show ID? Achter Show ID zit een ecosysteem van bedrijven die samenwerken. Bestuurders en functionarissen die staan ingeschreven bij KVK verstrekken eenmalige of periodieke machtigingen aan hun medewerkers. Een ontvangende partij ziet na het scannen van een QR-code de identiteit van de bezoeker en of deze persoon geautoriseerd is om te handelen. Gegevens kunnen direct in het systeem worden overgenomen. Overtypen is niet nodig. Zo wordt in één handeling gecontroleerd of de bezoeker toegang mag krijgen. Dit scheelt iedereen veel tijd en veel papierwerk.
Wat is voor jou het voordeel van het gebruik van ShowID?
De schipper en de beveiliging weten dat we eraan gaan komen. Dus dat gaat heel veel tijd schelen. Door middel van een QR-code op je telefoon weet iedereen waar jij bent en waar je naartoe moet. Heel makkelijk.
En ontstaan er nog extra kansen door het gebruik van dit systeem?
Ja, zeker. Als er bij de beveiliging een cursus gevolgd moet worden, dan kan je die alvast gewoon op je eigen werkplek doen. En dat scheelt daar weer tijd. Dus makkelijker en sneller.
Wat is het belang van ShowID in de scheepvaart?
De internationale scheepvaart heeft tegenwoordig te maken met de ISPS-code. Dat betekent dat degene die zich op een havenfaciliteit of in een schip moeten melden, dat ook zichzelf daarbij moeten gaan identificeren. Met name wat er allemaal achter de schermen gebeurt, is op dat moment voor degene die daar de toegang controleert eigenlijk weinig van bekend. En als je praat over de havenbeveiliger of degene die aan de gangway staat op het schip, dan kan die eigenlijk veel simpeler zien en sneller zien dat diegene ook daadwerkelijk daar hoort te zijn.
ShowID maakt toegangscontrole online en fysiek eenvoudig, snel en betrouwbaar. Privacyvriendelijk en papierloos. En met de zekerheid van het handelsregister van KVK.
So that's one of the experiments we actually did to try to see if the if we add value to actual processes like this one as physically entering a harbor, but you can translate this to entering buildings, construction sites, and all kinds of, in that area. So this was trying to explore how people reacted to actually having to check that when entering a physical location. Another use case we're about to start is with Irma. I don't know if you know that. It's an actual wallet. It already exists. I reveal my attributes, so you can see that's quite from the SSI way of thinking. We're going to try to set up an experiment with Joint Data, who is the verifier in this use case. And we're here, the emphasis is on working with the wallet in a digital way. Of course, we've seen different kinds of solutions for the wallet. So, as a Chamber of Commerce, we don't have any wallet specifically in mind. We think we are an oracle to blockchains or to SSI kind of ecosystems, and we should be agnostic to whatever wallet we choose. But Irma is an actual wallet. We can use it. We can cooperate with them. So we're taking that opportunity. I think Joost had quite a similar picture during his talk about having a data source, having a wallet, and having to share it. So this is the implementing Joost's story. First, the person in the middle, the dairy farmer, has to collect information, in this kind of Chamber of Commerce information. We assume that he already entered his personal information. And then he has to share that information to enter Joint Data, which is already a data sharing platform, so they already know the SSI components and the way of thinking. How does that work? You have to find the right company. Somehow, someone has to decide whether you, with your personal credentials, are allowed to act on behalf of that company. And if so, somehow we provide a credential which manifests in a card, which you can put into your wallet. So in this way, you collect as the farmer. This is what a farmer sees. The farmer then goes to has to share his information. Goes to this brilliantly designed Joint Data website, where he has to check the QR code with the Irma app. It asks whether all these credentials should be submitted, just like the picture of the driver's license or the Chamber of Commerce card in the Apple Wallet. It all works about the same. Are these credentials okay to share with the verifier at hand, Join Data? And if so, probably you get some success message in your wallet, but of course your attention will go to the Join Data platform where you can perform the actual tasks you are about to do. So here we've seen three completely different types of exercises we're doing, maybe to get them into production, but primarily to learn what these new technologies and these new concepts mean for trade register, for us as trade register, so a different, difficult word, as a trade register, and how we can provide trust from that, derive trust from that register also in the future. So the responsibilities, the IT impact security standards, and Chamber of Commerce as issuer, most likely with other governments like the Dutch Vehicle Agency, and more user-centric real use cases where actual users are about to use these kinds of concepts. This is all we had for today, I guess.